Hi everyone! I'm in Cambridge, this time the Cambridge in England. I've lived and worked here before I went to Boston. It's nice to come back from time to time to see friends, especially when it's summer. The days are longer for you to walk round Rose Crescent and colleges that seem to transport us back in time. Normally, things in university towns remain the same for hundreds of years, like roads in the Cambridge city centre will never be wide enough, or there'll never be a train line that links directly from Oxford to Cambridge, making each journey 3 hours long, plagued with train strikes. And sometimes when you're looking for specific amusements just to pass the time, like the famous Corpus Clock, you join a confused crowd and ask, where has it gone? And when you want to get a good picture of the magnificent King's College, you may find its chapel in scaffolding and soon fitted with solar panels on both sides of the roof. Shops close at 6 p.m. The most popular activity to do in Cambridge is, of course, punting. But this is how it looks like when it's raining. So, what to do when the weather is grim? I spend a lot of time at Heffers Bookshop. And on Trumpington Street, you'll find the Fitzwilliam Museum. The entry admission is free. This university museum was founded in 1816 by Viscount Richard Fitzwilliam. Once you walk in, you see that the founder's entrance looks like a Greek temple. It was opened by Queen Victoria in 1886. See if you can spot her marble bust, carved by Sir Alfred Gilbert, who's best known for the Eros statue in Piccadilly Circus, London. The Honourable Richard Fitzwilliam was a student at Trinity Hall, Cambridge. He left his library, art collection and £100,000 to the university at his death in 1816. So you may have also come across Fitzwilliam Street and Fitzwilliam College. The ceiling with its ornate plasterwork makes it look like tunnels connecting a flow of art. In golden frames, there are more Pre-Raphaelite paintings like the ones I mentioned in my Leighton House video. Let's go on a brief tour where I'll highlight some of my favourite museum items. These treasures are just tip of the iceberg. Some of the installations may have a shock factor. Some galleries may be closed for refurbishment. Art pieces are shuffled around. I think going to museums requires an open mind. There was a special exhibition when I went. It's called Islanders. Originally, it's a four-year research project exploring the cultural identities of Mediterranean islanders as opposed to the surrounding mainland. There were around 200 objects like this, dating from the Neolithic era to the Roman period. I'm surprised that they were preserved so well. The exhibition used Crete, Cyprus, and Sardinia as examples. But I find a lot of the figurines and symbols for worship are quite universal. If you're lucky, you'll see artists come here to sketch. But there are some very fine, delicate pieces that I had to zoom in up close. Some of them, I'd never have guessed what they are. Maybe you'd like to take a guess? The exhibits were priceless. They were made in hundreds, if not a thousand years before Christ. But showing them this way doesn't really resonate with me. It's supposed to show that even ancient islands were not insular, but influenced by their neighbors in trade and in culture. If you look back at the entrance, it posed the question, what does it mean to be an islander today? But there's no indication of linking this exhibition to islands like the United Kingdom, Japan, or Taiwan. Islanders didn't just worry about putting food on the table, but appreciated art, beauty, and honored life after death. Somehow, at the end of the exhibition, there's a conflicting message. This gut-wrenching poem describes diaspora and the sense of being in exile. For all who've left their homelands, this poem may finally strike a chord.